Hi everyone, my name is Alain Kapatashvungu, co-founder of Frontdoor. I'm really, really grateful and excited because I get to talk with someone that I admire, somebody who really has his finger on the pulse of our industry. So that's going to be really interesting to hear from him and learn from him. I'm talking about Bob Galberg, obviously the CEO of the National Association of Realtors. So Bob, first of all, how are you doing today?
Great, Alan. We're persevering another day, doing Zoom calls all day. I always now refer to this world as this is our now normal, not a new normal, a now normal, because this will be continuing well after the pandemic, where we'll be doing these kind of events to reach and listen to more people.
I agree. Definitely agree on that one. So, Bob, to kind of get us started, the first thing that I wanted to ask you about is, so as the CEO of NAR, and you lead this pretty much the largest trade association in the world, and as of August, I think the number were close to maybe 1.5 million almost, which is just impressive. And add to that, you have a staff of like 350 some staff members. So pretty much, how did you do it? How did you manage to stay on top of not only your staff, but also your members' needs during this pandemic, pretty much?
Like everyone, when this thing hit, we looked at everything that we do at the time in March, when this was really beginning to take root with this pandemic and the issues, and even through the last 7+ months, we always looked at putting the safety of our members and our staff at the forefront of every decision that we make.
Absolutely.
So when you look at it, our organization and our staff has been just readily available to our members.
Okay.
I would probably argue that we're engaging more with members now via a virtual setup than we were when we were doing in-person and social media.
Wow.
I'll give you an idea. When March happened and the pandemic was being talked about before there was a national declaration and a worldwide declaration of all the safety measures, we took some bold actions. In early March, we canceled our Association Executives Institute that was supposed to happen literally the end of the first week in March in San Diego. And I will tell you, myself and my leadership caught a little flack for that because there were people that said we were overreacting.
Yeah.
And I'm glad we overreacted because it ended up being the right decision.
Exactly.
Because even during that time, I put into place something that was a little controversial, but I told all of our staff to stay home for 2 days. This is, again, before the pandemic.
Yes.
So we could test all of our infrastructure in case the worst thing ever happened, which candidly, I didn't believe that was really going to happen.
Yes.
So all the staff stayed home for 2 straight days, the first week and a half of March.
Okay.
We tested all of our infrastructure, our IT systems, how we would work virtually if we ever had to go there, again, not thinking we would.
Yes.
And within another 2 weeks, everyone had declared a national pandemic.
That's incredible.
People should work remote. And fortunately, we had already done the advanced work to make sure that we were ready to go.
Absolutely.
And I will tell you that even to this day, we have engaged hundreds of thousands of our members on a virtual platform technologies.
That's incredible.
To, most importantly, listen to what our members have to say,
yes,
but also to engage them. And never before have we been able to be exposed with our leadership team and our staff with
That's
more
huge.
Of our members and listening to what they have to say. So that is where we've really stepped up in that regard to be able to serve our members.
That's really, really huge. And especially, again, you lead the largest trade association in the world. So just to kind of imagine the numbers and the way you guys have been able to do it, it's just incredible. And I love the fact that you've been able to even anticipate it a little bit by saying, okay, everybody just stay at home for 2 days. Then they had the capacity to actually see like how it would look like if you guys had to do it. So that's goes pretty much a long way. That's incredible.
Yeah, and I'll add one other thing. So this created a lot of firsts for us and every other business. During that time in March when everybody was then forced to work remote, we were now engaging on Zoom platforms and WebExes, you name it, we were on it, we still do it. But we did something that was really the first for us as an association, and I would imagine for other associations. We held our first virtual budget meetings. They're usually in person with close to 100 people.
Yes.
We had our finance committee meeting virtually, and then we go to our annual, our mid-year meetings, our legislative meetings that took place in May. There's a story that's something that I think is our silver lining. That meeting typically gets around 8,500 people that come to DC. We use it to network, but we also use it to do meetings on Capitol Hill.
Yes, yes.
Guess what? We did it virtual this year, and we had over 28,500 members that registered.
That's incredible.
So almost four times the amount of people were engaged, and we were still doing meetings on Capitol Hill virtually, as we still do today. So now Congress people, people in the administration, we're now meeting with our members who would typically go up to their offices on Capitol Hill. Now we're sitting there doing virtual town halls with those legislators, talking to more of our members, and we're able to advance policies that we think, number one, first and foremost, help our consumers that we serve, as well as our industry. So there's, again, a silver lining to show that because we went virtual, it was something that actually enhanced our relationship with our members and our constituents.
I really, really love what you're saying there, Bob. The silver lining that I always, that I get in everything that you're just sharing with us, it's all about efficiency. When I hear you talk, I just hear we've been efficient. We've been able to be even more efficient than we were before, which is just, when you put it in perspective, pretty much amazing. Because this thing kind of hit from all sides. Nobody could have obviously predicted this. And the fact that you guys, as such a large trading association, have been able to do it, it's just another testament to your leadership, but to also putting to the incredible team that you guys have over there.
Absolutely.
Oh, awesome. You pretty much kind of touched a little bit, but maybe you can go into a little bit much further detail. So can you talk to us a little bit about some of the measures that you have implemented in these times to continue to educate but also empower real estate professionals, just to make sure that they are armed with proper resources, tools, things of that nature?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of areas. You know, you talk about where you're able to shine the light as to the importance of an association is now more valuable than ever before. We would have never predicted it would take a pandemic, but I will tell you the things that we were able to step up and do. You know, we have a great elected leadership team that the members select as their president and their president-elect and their treasurer, et cetera. And they came together very quickly with my team, with my staff, and we talked together and we said, what resources can we put in place? You know, within 3 weeks after this pandemic had been established around the world, and everyone is working remote and we're not sure what's going to happen and the economy was tanking, we launched a program, probably the best set of resources that we've ever done in the history of NAR, and we called it Right Tools Right Now.
Wow.
And the idea behind that program was that we said, what products and services and education can we bring to our members for free or at cost? We have a whole litany of products and services, hundreds and hundreds of these that we charge for because it's a way for us to drive some non-dues revenue that pay for programs and serve our members. Absolutely. We decided basically to clear our warehouse and said, you know what? Let's give as much away to our members as possible that they could have these tools to use and help them be successful. So to date, to give you an idea, we've had nearly 300,000 of our members take one or more of those products for free or at our cost.
That's amazing.
And the key number here is the value that it has provided those members is nearly $23 million.
That's amazing.
Of give back to our members.
Incredible.
So members have taken over 700,000 different products and services and education. Like one of our certification programs is called ePro.
Yeah.
ePro is a great program. You can actually get your ePro for free now because we felt like it was important to give up those dollars and give it back to the members so that these tools, if it can help them make even one sale, it can really be the best payback we could ever do. So I think that was an example of leadership moving quickly.
Absolutely, absolutely.
No bureaucracy, make it available. It's still available. Members can go to nar.realtor/RTRN to take advantage of this program. So Alan, that's one example. I think the other one that I'm really equally as proud of is we launched a members telehealth benefit.
Okay.
You know, when the pandemic hit, you were hearing all the officials with the CDC, you heard Dr. Fauci saying this, which is, if you're thinking you're not feeling good, now, first of all, if you think, you know, God forbid you've got the virus, you need to talk to your doctor. Exactly. But the most important thing was people were fearful to go into an emergency room for routine things or going into their doctor's offices. So we launched a members telehealth program where members can go 24/7 with access to nearly 3,000 doctors and specialists.
That is so awesome.
They can actually go on a computer just like this, talk to them about any issues that they've got, and these doctors can prescribe medicines from a pharmacy. And that program alone has got nearly 35,000 of our members and their families. But here's the beautiful part about it. Members only pay $7 a month for themselves and their families. They can have as many kids and family up to age 26 involved.
Incredible.
NAR makes no money on this. It's what it cost us. We give it back to the members to use. But again, it was another way, because I feel very strongly that the health and welfare of our members is the most important thing that we can care about.
Agreed.
So putting these kind of programs out there and these tools, et cetera, is just extremely, extremely important.
That's incredible.
And I will tell you, the members, the feedback we get is just incredible about how happy they are that NAR and our state associations and our local associations have stepped up. And I think the other area probably goes as one of the most primary things that we do is our advocacy efforts. Talk about resources that help our members. Right. When the federal government was looking at the stimulus programs, and still are, NAR, being the largest independent, representing independent contractors, felt it was imperative that when the CARES Act was coming out and the stimulus programs, that independent contractors, which is the majority of our members, are represented. Because at first, there wasn't a lot of language to help them. Yes. So the pandemic, the PPP, Paycheck Relief Program, that was there, the Paycheck Protection Program, the PPP. For example, the pandemic unemployment assistance. Typically, members, because they're independent contractors, are not eligible for unemployment insurance. Yes. That's administered by the states. But NAR lobbied really hard to be the voice with both the House, the Senate, and the administration to say, when you put a package together, it is imperative that our members who are independent contractors also get some relief.
Yes.
So when the PUA program was released, it was because of, in large part, NAR and our states and locals working together to tell the federal government that we need to have a program. The beauty of that program is that the states, which typically the state governments, which pay for unemployment insurance through the state employment, the states don't have to pay for this. This comes out of the federal relief program. And so NAR, in good part, was there to help lobby for that. We worked with the Small Business Administration to ensure that the tools were there. And we just made an announcement today that with a lot of the work is that just in the last day and a half, the feds have released a shortened form so that our members, and I'll give you an idea, one out of every five of our members took advantage of the PPP program, Paycheck Protection Program.
Got it.
The 1.5-page form that was just released is so that folks can fill that out to ask for forgiveness in paying back loans, $50,000 or less.
Awesome.
So we've been very active in making that happen. And what I love is for the next stimulus package that will come out, we've been lobbying that forgiveness should actually apply for loans of $150,000 and less. So we're still working that every single day, and talk about great resources. The work that we do at the federal level and the work our states do at the state level and the locals is what makes that worthwhile.
That's awesome. The level of reactivity is just unparalleled. Like I've been able to talk to a few people, and Bob, what you guys are doing over there is just incredible, pretty much in revolt to me. So that must be fantastic to not only be a member, but to see that as an association, as a group, you guys are taking that much care of one another. That is just fantastic.
Absolutely.
I love it. So you kind of touched on it a little bit early on, but we can get it maybe a little bit further as well. Like what are some of the lessons that you have learned during this crisis, Bob, as it pertains to stewardship? Because that's what you do, literally. You steward this incredible ship. That is NAR. What are some of the lessons that you could share with us that pertains to stewardship in these difficult times?
Yeah, you know, I think we touched on it a bit, but yes. I think it's the fact that the association has been able to step up. We always step up on behalf of our members.
Agreed.
But when the dire situation happened, when the pandemic hit in the March and April, May timeframes, our economy is doing right now what our chief economist calls a V recovery. Now, what does that mean? The economy just tanked. It went straight down for those 2.5-3 months. It has now gone back 100% the other way and more.
Got it.
So our sales activity right now is actually exceeding where it was pre-pandemic.
Wow.
So some of the silver linings you see here is that yes, real estate has rebounded. Now, there's still not enough inventory that's there, but I think the thing that we have all been able to learn is, you know, the pandemic forced us all as a country, all as a world,
Agreed.
That we have to do things differently.
Absolutely.
So I really want to play up what we've done. For example, a lot of people don't realize this, and it's a story I know you know about it.
Yeah.
But we have an entity; it's a wholly owned subsidiary of NAR called Second Century Ventures, yes. And we have a program called REACH. It's an
Absolutely.
Accelerator program for startup companies.
Yeah.
Most folks don't realize that NAR, through that subsidiary, has equity investment in over 100 technology companies.
That's incredible.
It is incredible.
We've actually
been named one of the top 20 most successful accelerators in the world by MIT. And let me give you an idea. It's not just in real estate. It's all types of technology accelerators.
Absolutely.
And the reason we did that, and this is where it shows strong in this situation, is the fact that of those 100 plus companies, I think people know DocuSign. We're
yes.
one of the first investors in DocuSign. But the industry had to change also because business was thwarted.
Agreed.
So we were forced to do virtual, our members, you know, virtual tours, virtual open houses.
Absolutely.
Electronic closings.
Yes.
How do we do all those? Well, for example, NAR several years ago, yes, we have an investment in DocuSign. We also have investment in two remote online notary companies,
yes.
Notarize and Notary.com.
Great companies.
Now, the idea behind that was we wanted to get involved with companies that could help change the real estate vertical to be realtor advocates
yes.
instead of realtor adversaries. That has proved very successful because
Agreed.
When the industry went in shutdown and things had to be done full electronic closings, many of our members were already taking advantage of those tools that NAR was providing and other tools out there, companies like yourself.
Yes.
I mean, there's lots of great products and services that our members were really forced to move to faster
Agreed.
Because they needed to survive. And I think that's what we're seeing is going to come out of this, is that we've got folks around the country and worldwide that are using these tools in real estate transactions that may have not happened as fast, except for the fact that pandemic pushed us and forced the industry to have to move to better technologies
awesome.
And more efficiencies.
That is definitely awesome and highly deserved, by the way, that ranking, because you guys have been pushing the envelope. For I don't know how many years, but yeah, I'm fortunate enough to know a few people in that realm in the NAR REACH classes. So I've been following what you guys have been doing, and it has been fantastic for years and years and years out. So
and you know, an interesting and an interesting thing, Alan, not to interrupt you there, but I will tell you that the success of what we've done with these programs is we have announced those same kind of programs. Yes. It's called REACH again. It's our real estate accelerator. So we just announced a program in the last year. We have REACH Australia.
Yeah.
We have REACH UK.
UK, yes.
Yeah, we have REACH Canada.
Yeah.
We have REACH Commercial for our practitioners. So we continue to look at different places around the world because the idea is this. Some of the tools and technologies that are being introduced by great entrepreneurs all around the world can be things that we can bring to our members and members even outside and real estate practitioners outside the industry, outside our membership, to take advantage of these. So, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with Box Brownie.
I do.
Great, great photo enhancement product that many of our members in the States use. We found them in Australia.
Australia.
So the idea there is find the best breed of technology anywhere in the world, and how do we bring it to life and give a tool to our members? Because the whole idea behind the REACH program is the fact that there are so many people worldwide in technologies that would love nothing better than to disintermediate our members and take control of the multi-trillion-dollar real estate world.
Yeah.
And so our idea was give our members a fighting chance. Bring these tools and technologies, put more arrows in the quiver, and allow them to be successful.
Absolutely.
And that way, those tools help our members stay a step ahead. That's what we're really here to do. And that is one of the other things that I think will be when we take a look back and say, what good came out of this pandemic? Because there's not a lot.
Yeah.
But I will tell you, in terms of advancing the cause of technology and efficiencies that benefit the consumer.
Agreed.
Look at what we're all doing.
Absolutely. Completely agree on, with you on that one. On another topic, this is something that I know you've addressed, and I love how, once again, how you guys have been leading the charge as well on this subject. But I would just kind of wanted to have your thoughts as well on this, especially because this is an industry that I deeply, deeply love and work into. So, in your opinion, Bob, like, what can we practically do to further improve diversity and inclusion, especially in our industry? Because as it relates to whether, you know, more realtors of color or real estate technology entrepreneurs like myself and other people, like, what can we practically do? Because as you know, we tend to talk a lot about it, but I don't feel like really something meaningful has been done on that subject, and I wanted to have your thoughts on it.
Yeah, and thank you for the question, because this has been such a difficult year, certainly for our nation and really for the world. You know, I will tell you, this is an area that I feel most proud about as my tenure as CEO. When I came in 3 years ago, diversity and equity and inclusion was one of my three top pillars of what I wanted to see change in this industry. So we didn't just react to the current events that happened with the unfortunate murder of George Floyd.
Yes.
We were already dealing with this. Even last year on my team, NAR put out its first ever diversity and inclusion statement on NAR.realtor.
Awesome.
And we had it developed by a multicultural group of our employees.
Awesome.
That we wanted to be able to show and demonstrate that we are not the same NAR that we used to be.
Yes.
You know, unfortunately, NAR, as recent as the 70s, did not have a great track record with how we treated people, our own members, or who we allowed to be in this association,
absolutely,
let alone how consumers deal with it. So I will tell you one of the things that I think is a pillar of success that we can point to, and we got a lot of work to still do.
Yeah.
But last November and December, President Vince Malta, who's a great leader, with our leadership team and my staff came together and said, what are we going to do to double down on fair housing and make fairness in this area? In December and January, I brought on a board a gentleman named Brian Green.
Okay.
He is our director of fair housing.
Got it.
Brian came to us from HUD.
Okay.
He was the undersecretary for fair housing.
Got it.
And we brought him on board to deal with creating programs to ensure better equity and fair housing in the real estate industry. Now, again, it's not just on the real estate side. It also deals with things like appraisal and lending and all the other aspects of the real estate life cycle.
That's awesome.
Your listeners probably have heard about the incident that happened up in Long Island,
okay,
where there was a video done by Newsday newspaper, which showed undercover some real estate practitioners, unfortunately, steering people to certain neighborhoods, et cetera. Some were, in fact, our members. That is unacceptable.
Okay.
And the great news was we already had Brian on board before that happened.
That's awesome.
So it wasn't like we just reacted to that situation. Exactly. Brian has been bringing us a set of programs with his team.
Okay.
We just announced it. It's called ACT. It stands for Accountability, Culture Change, and Training in the whole fair housing and fairness arena.
Awesome.
So if you go to NAR.realtor, you'll see the ACT program in fair housing. Okay. We also released an implicit bias video that we've asked every member in the country to look at. It's about a 45-minute video.
Okay.
Incredible video that everybody should take advantage of. So we have real estate brokers showing it to all their offices. And then lastly, and by no means is this the total list. We've got so many things. We just released this week a consumer advertising campaign on fair housing.
Okay.
And it is powerful, it is edgy, and it gets to the point.
That's awesome.
That realtors will be the ones that change the fairness in housing and equity in housing, and we will drive this issue first and foremost.
Completely agree. That's awesome. Those are really, really great idea and directions and measures, and I can't wait to see how those things will start to form. So that those are really, really good avenues. To kind of close this up, Bob, do you think that you touched on it as well a little bit early, but do you think that this hiatus that we went through, this forced one, pretty much forced our industry to reimagine or rethink how work gets done? Do you think this is something that's going to change down the road, or we found pretty much a new way to work, whether it's on an agent standpoint, on a consumer standpoint? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, and I touched on it. I think absolutely, definitely. As we talked about, the now normal is here.
Yes.
Electronic efficiencies. I mean, even how the association works and engages our members. We did a leadership live event with our leadership. It was shown through Facebook Live.
Okay.
We had 19,000 people that watched it live.
That's
but
incredible.
Within 2 days after, over 100,000 of our members had seen it.
Wow.
Never before have we ever been able to reach and engage. And I will say this, listening to our members is paramount. It gives us a chance to be the association our members really want. Yeah. So the way the association at NAR is going to operate with all of our associations will be like this.
Okay.
Virtual. It'll be hybrids. Well, we'll do in-person events. We'll do virtual events. And same with our industry and our members, because consumers expect it.
Absolutely.
Consumers want the efficiency of being able to do things faster and easier and more timely in real estate transactions. And when I tell you how many people have done real estate transactions on properties sight unseen, total soup to nuts, electronic, we never saw it with those numbers. And I think we're going to see elements of that continue well after this pandemic ends. And at the end of the day, that's still a better thing, because the consumers will drive what's most important as to what they want. And our industry's got to be there to make sure we represent and reaffirm our commitment to what the industry and what people that are buying and selling any kind of property are looking for.
Absolutely. Wow. Thank you, Bob. That was a treat for me today. That's a wrap of this week's episode with Bob Galberg, CEO of the National Association of Realtors. You can catch this episode on YouTube or all platform streaming podcasts. And remember, in the recovery, don't just get back to the same place, but strive to get to a better place. Thank you very much, Bob.
Hey, my honor and my privilege. Thank you, my friend.
It was a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Absolutely. Okay, yeah, absolutely. Bye-bye. All right.